Well, there are many people who say that, though, that you are entirely mistaken if you believe that this is a world communist movement, because every communist is a socialist. And you remember that Khrushchev talked about your grandchildren living not under communism but under socialism. And the real problem is the socialist movement. Indeed, there is an organization known as the Socialist Internationale. It is one of the three or four most powerful nations in the world, and most Americans have never even heard of it. But at the present time, the Prime Minister of England, Tony Blair, is a vice president, and the Prime Minister of France, and the Prime Minister of Germany, and of Italy, and of Spain, they're all vice presidents of the Socialist Internationale. They held regular meetings. They're planning on a world government, and they work towards exactly the same goal that the communists do, a one world government, a new economic system, and a new spirituality. But of course, the question is not what sort of world are we moving into, but who's going to run it? And the socialists believe they're going to be in control. The Socialist International has regular meetings, and if you have access to the internet, you can look up their website and verify who the people are who are involved in this. Now, if you go to Ombury St. Mary, which is the Beatrice Webb House, it's about 30 miles south of London. I've been there, a beautiful estate where the socialists meet on a regular basis to plan the new world. And they had there, it was stolen, but they had there a stained glass window. We have in the original color, but this is simply a black and white reproduction. And this is where you can see their coat of arms. Their coat of arms, you'll see between the two men on the right, is a wolf dressed in sheep's clothing, because everything is deception. You see, FS for Fabian Socialism, the use of deception to fool the world. On the right, you see George Bernard Shaw, and then just to the a little to the left, you see Sidney Webb. Each one of them holding a hammer. Shaw is holding the world on an anvil. The caption above, remold it nearer to the heart's desire. They are remaking the world. Now, then on the below, you see pray devoutly, hammer stoutly. And so they are going to simply remold the world. That's what it's really all about. And below, you see all of these men kneeling before a list of books, among are Plato's writings, and the great philosophers, because these men worship reason rather than God. And on the left, you see H.G. Wells thumbing his nose at everything going on. An excellent book, The Great Deceit, written by a man named Zygmunt Dobbs. And Zygmunt Dobbs was the number two man in the CIO. That was the coal workers' union, second only to John L. Lewis. And in about 1950-51, the Congress was investigating communist infiltration of our labor movement. And he was asked to testify. He testified about the communists, because he was concerned about the subversive influence within the American labor movement. And the very evening that he was after he had testified about communism and American labor unions, why John L. Lewis and Walter Reuther and his brother and the leaders of American labor, which is largely controlled by people dedicated to socialism, met and they banned Zygmunt Dobbs from ever again being involved in the American labor movement. And he couldn't understand why these men who were not themselves communists would be so concerned because of his exposure of the communist or subversive influence within American labor. And so he spent the rest of his life studying this. He wrote several books, among which was The Great Deceit. And of course, what he found out is that the communists and the socialists always work together. They all want the same objective and goal. It's simply who's going to be in charge when this whole thing comes about. And then there are others who will tell you, well, it's really not the communists or the socialists, but indeed it is the humanists. Because every communist is a humanist, and every socialist is a humanist, and they constantly work together. Now, the humanists have all sorts of organizations, most of which I belong to, because I'm a researcher, really, and I want to get their literature. This is the Humanist Manifesto. They published this, Volume 1 and Volume 2, the first written in 1933, the second written in 1973. And here they lay out what they're about. They are pro-abortion. They see nothing wrong with homosexuality. They believe that the criminal needs somebody to back them up and to be behind them to protect them from the criminal justice system. And so they support many times what the criminals are doing. They don't. They think that they need someone to champion their cause to make sure they get justice. They believe there is no God. They believe there's no right or wrong. They believe our children should be taught that they are to determine whatever they want to do, not having any rules that are brought forward by religious organizations. They are dedicated to socialism. They're dedicated to world government. Every humanist is a socialist, dedicated to world government and to socialism. Not every humanist is a communist, but every socialist is a humanist, and every humanist is a socialist. And so there's some people who believe that humanism is the common denominator for everything going on in the world today. There are others, of course, who will tell you that the real force behind what's going on is the tax-exempt foundations. The Rockefeller Foundation, the Carnegie Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the Pew Charitable Trust, the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, because these organizations, if you study them, are financing communism and socialism here in the United States. In 1953, Congress commissioned the Reese Committee, headed by Congressman B. Carroll Reese, to investigate the great tax-exempt foundations to find out why they had funded the propaganda arm of the Chinese Communist movement in the United States in the late 1940s to convince the American people that Chairman Mao was not a communist but was an agrarian reformer, and that if China went communist, it would be good for the Chinese people. And what they found out, of course, is that the great foundations were working not only to back the Chinese communists, they were actually funding the communist movement in the United States and the socialist movement in the United States, that infiltrated our educational system. They had put their people into key positions in many of the major universities. They had rewritten our textbooks. They had rewritten our encyclopedias. There was an interplay between our government and the foundations. And one example would be Dean Rusk. Dean Rusk just happened to be a Rhodes Scholar who worked for the Rockefeller Foundation, who went into the State Department as Undersecretary of State for Far Eastern Affairs, worked there to bring communism to China, and then, of course, to get us into the Korean War, which was to take our attention off of the tragedy of what had happened in China. And then Dean Rusk left the government and went back to the Rockefeller Foundation, now as the president. He stayed at the Rockefeller Foundation for 8 years. He went back then into government as Secretary of State to get us involved in the no-win war in Vietnam. And then, of course, he goes back to as president of the Rockefeller Foundation. McGeorge Bundy, who was the director of the National Security Council, getting us involved in Vietnam, went to work as the president of the Ford Foundation. So there's an interlock every place between foundations and government. And it's sort of like musical chairs. And there are many people who honestly believe that the foundations are at the core of everything going on in the world today.